on OTB Sports Radio.
With Vodafone, official sponsors of the Irish rugby team. Team of us, everyone in.
Sexton promotes at the 10-metre line. It's spinning!
It looks good.
Le drop de Jonathan Sexton!
Rugby World Cup on Off the Ball. Updates, analysis and opinion across all OTB channels from start to finish. This is OTB Sports Radio.
OTB Sports Radio.
Than half an hour to go now until Ireland and New Zealand kick off in Tokyo in a couple of hours' time. Either Joe Schmidt's time in Ireland, time in charge of Ireland, will be over, or his team will be heading to a first ever World Cup semi-final after what would unquestionably be their best ever result at the tournament. What are your predictions? Get them into us now on our social channels. We're streaming live on offtheball.com, OTB Sports Radio and the Go Loud app, and you can also watch us on video through our YouTube, Twitter and Facebook accounts, streaming live at Off the Ball on Twitter if you want to get in touch with us. And all of our rugby coverage here on Off the Ball is brought to you by Vodafone, team of us, everyone in. I'm here with Johne Murphy, and before we look ahead to Ireland and New Zealand, a reminder that we do know who the winner of this will play. England back in the World Cup semi-final for the first time since 2007. A comprehensive 40 points to 16 win against Australia, pulling clear in the second half with tries for Kyle Sinclair and Anthony Watson, Owen Farrell kicking four conversions and four penalties as well. Johnny May, scoring two tries. And that leads me nicely in to Johne Murphy, who is beside me. Johnny, would this morning's result give you a little bit more confidence heading into this, that, you know, there might be one shock in the quarterfinals, at least we didn't have it this morning?
Hopefully so. I think England were very impressive. You know, they just kind of kicked into a different gear last 20-30 minutes. So, hopefully, you know, I think a lot of people are probably are thinking that shock might be tomorrow and potentially Japan and South Africa. But look, hopefully we can do it and get over the line today.
Overall, how are you feeling? Has the mind kind of changed throughout the week?
It has. Different things have happened. And then, you know, you think about selection and, you know, probably someone like Jordan Larmour, you're probably disappointed he's not playing. But then you look at the tried and tested method and the experience that Rob Kearney brings into the backfield. You think they're going to use their kicking game and try to isolate Beauden Bard as much as they can, like they did this time last year in Dublin. So, I think the handicap might be a small bit rich. It's going to be a tough ask for them, but I'm, you know, there's just a lot of will and want from everyone that they do succeed, and you know, I really hope for them that they do. But it's a monumental task ahead of them.
Yeah, let's just run through the teams quickly now. So Ireland starting with Rob Kearney at fullback, Keith Earls and Jacob Stockdale on the wings, Gary Ringrose and Robbie Henshaw on the centre, with Conor Murray and Johnny Sexton in the halfbacks, partnering together. The most experienced halfback partnership ever in Irish rugby. Cian Healy, Rory Best and Tadhg Furlong then in the front row, with Ian Henderson and James Ryan behind them, and Peter O'Mahony, Josh van der Fleer and CJ Stander completing the side, with Niall Scannell, Dave Kilcoyne, Andrew Porter, Tadhg Byrne, Reese Ruddock, Luke McGrath, Joey Carberry and Jordan Larmour on the bench. New Zealand, meanwhile, they are going with their tried and trusted of the last few months, with Richie Mwangi at 10, which means Beauden Barrett starts at fullback. Sevi Rhys and George Bridge, just 12 caps between that wing pair on the wings. Jack Goodhue and Anton Leonard Brown in the centre, with Mwanga partnered with Aaron Smith in the halfbacks. In the front row, it's Joe Moody, Cody Taylor and Nepo Laulala, Brody Redelich and Sam Whitelock in the second row, Artie Saviak, Sam Kane and Kieran Reid completing the side, with the substitutes bench, Dane Coles, Ofa Tuengafasi, Angus Taevo, Scott Barrett, Matt Todd, TJ Perenara, Sonny Bill Williams and Jordan Barrett. Johnny, it just shows how different the New Zealand team is to the one that played against Ireland in Dublin a year ago. Seven changes to that side. It kind of just shows how much a New Zealand team evolves and how kind of ruthless their selection policy is.
I think, you know, when there's a heavy reliance on the Crusaders and you know how they've performed over the last 12 months, and I think that's you know, it just shows that it is a conveyor belt and it keeps coming. And you know, if you don't perform one or two games, there's someone, you know, there's probably two or three people lining up behind you to take your spot. And you know, over the years, you know, Steve Hansen hasn't been afraid to pick the informed person, regardless of what they have done previously over the last 18 months to 2 years. So I think that's just shows exactly they are probably the team that you know, I'd say them and England are probably the two favourites in terms of their form just starting. If you look at the tournament in isolation and who they've beat and how they've beaten them, so. I think that's just a good thing. There's no one, you know, your training standards have to be at an extremely high level. There's no resting on your laurels whatsoever. You know that every time you're on the training park, be it a training session or a match, you have to perform or else the next person's going to be in ahead of you.
Yeah, and of all the people who've been kind of left out over the last few months, even looking at guys like Carl Tunakwefe, Ben Smith, Ryan Crotty, Rico Ioane not even being in a match day 23, it just kind of shows how ruthless it is and the depth of talent that New Zealand are working with.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, Ben Smith is probably a case in point in terms of what he's been and how he's been such a linchpin, you know, be it in the backfield for a long time. But I think that just shows you how. I wouldn't necessarily call it ruthless, but I'd just call it professional. Their viewpoint is towards selection. You know, that if you don't perform, that's it. You know, and it's clear lines. And you'd find that everyone in their environment pushes towards that. And if you're not played, they accept it and they make sure that they do their job in terms of pushing the training standards for everyone else.
What scares you in the New Zealand team? What doesn't scare you?
Yeah, well, that's the thing. I think if, you know, for me, it's going to be built around kind of the game is going to be built around the triangle of, you know, Mwanga, Barrett and Smith versus Murray, Sexton and Kearney for me. You know, I think if those three guys from New Zealand are let control the game, Bowden Barrett, you know, his running style, and if he can control the blind side from an attack perspective, I think we'll be in massive trouble. Where if Murray and Sexton and Kearney with his left foot can manipulate the backfield and get on top there and use Bowden Barrett and turn him into a weakness, then I think Ireland have a massive chance. Same for Smith and Mwanga. You would hope that our halfbacks can control the game more, use our kicking game, create mismatches in the air, win those scraps on the ground. Then there's an opportunity where, you know, Ireland let Smith and Mwanga get into this, you know, their free-flowing game. You know, they're offloading. Then Ireland would be. I think Ireland going to be in for a long day if they let that happen. So, you know, those three players on both sides, those are for me, are massively important.
You're saying they have to turn Bowden Barrett into a weakness. How do you go about doing that? What do Ireland have to do there?
I think if you look at Jacob Stockdale's try, that is the copy of what we want to do. You know, there was a little trick play, switch the play back. Bowden Barrett is completely in the wrong area, and then Stockdale's chip kick completely overshows that he's not covering the backfield the way he should. He's completely overshot, looking to close the gate very hard on the open side, which means that you can drag the blind side winger up it. You can isolate him, and then when you play him behind that, then you're getting a load of ground. So it's to move that, and I think that's probably why Rob Kearney and Joe Smith before in his interview has alluded to that. You know, he referenced Rob Kearney's kicking game twice in the interview. So I think that shows that left foot option means that, you know, Baird is always in two minds whether, you know, Rob Kearney can stand up on the left side and ping it down to the left-hand corner. Obviously, Murray and Sexton can control that right hand and that open side and ping it down to the right-hand side. So it can isolate him in that backfield kick battle.
And if the kicking is loose, if it's a little bit too long, you're in a lot of trouble against Barrett.
Yeah, because you kick to him loosely, then you're opening up his running game, which is potentially one of the best in the world. You know, you saw you know, just a simple 1v1 against Conor Murray last year, and his pace off the mark just gets on that outside shoulder. And if you can't get your feet positioned correct and you're lunging towards him, he's just going to use your fender and isolate you. So you can't kick loosely to him. So it's kind of that catch-22. If you kick well and you get space and you manipulate him and you move him around, then yeah, he's in trouble. But if he catches the ball square in his hands and it's a loose kick to him, then we're in trouble.
Xavier Rees hasn't been in Test rugby particularly long, only a few months really since he made his debut with them. he is incredibly dangerous out in that wing, though. The speed he has, just the natural pace and power. And we've seen he's been pretty devastating against a lot of teams already in both the Rugby Championship and in the tournament.
Yeah, you know, I think that's... I don't think with New Zealand, I don't think, you know, the experience really is an issue in terms of where they play. And as we've spoken about, it's just a conveyor belt, you know. So the pressure necessary, you know, and I think he just goes out, he performs... if he gets the ball in his hand and he performs the way he has, he's going to be a big, big danger. But I don't think the inexperience, particularly from New Zealand, really counts for that much, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. There's a few nice stats doing the rounds. One of them, it kind of just shows the ability of New Zealand to work through the paces and how winning the territory battle is only going to be half the battle for Ireland. New Zealand have scored more tries in this tournament with possession starting in their own half than they have with possession starting in the opposition 22. So it really just shows that they're comfortable, they're more than comfortable to hang on to the ball and work their way up the field rather than just kind of striking first phase, and you know that's where the danger is almost.
Yeah, but I think that's probably, again, like Barrett, that's one of their biggest strengths but also can be one of their weaknesses. I think Farrell's defensive system with the Lions and over the last couple of years from an Ireland perspective has really shut that down massively at times, and I think that can, if Ireland get to their fence right and go full court press, as I describe it, really push hard into their faces and take them, say, right, well, kick us back the ball then. We'll take you on in a kick-kick battle. That then can fall into Ireland's favour, where if they get that wrong and they get their connections and their communication wrong in the defensive line and they do go full court press and there's holes, guys shooting up in the wrong space, getting ahead of each other, not staying in that line, then they could be in for a long day. So that's the thing. The two things for me that will probably decide the game can be New Zealand's biggest strengths, but you can turn that into weakness. And Farrell has shown that with his defensive systems, and we have shown that previously with our kicking game against Bowden Barrett. But they don't pay off, then you're in for it could be not a nice evening in Japan.
Yeah, and one of the issues as well is you could control the game against New Zealand for 65-70 minutes, but those 10 minutes where you lose control of it a little bit, that is the making or breaking of the game. We saw it against South Africa, how, you know, New Zealand, their two tries came within a 5-minute period. Ireland, in each of the last three games, have had a little 5 to 10 minute slump in kind of the latter stages of the first half. They had it against Japan. That's when they let them back into the game, conceding penalties. Against Russia, things slowed down coming up towards halftime. And same again against Samoa last week, in and around Bundiaki's red card. If Ireland are to have a period like that as well, New Zealand, they can put two or three tries on you in the space of 10 minutes, and that could be the game, essentially.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, going back 3 or 4 years, you know, I think, you know, all New Zealand needed to beat Ireland was 3 minutes and 43 seconds or whatever, so you can't switch off at any stage. They'll know that. But the thing about Ireland is they don't... There's 7 or 8 players in this 23 today that don't have any fear of the All Blacks. They have a winning record. Mm. People like Joey Carberry, Josh van der Fleer, these guys, they have a winning record against New Zealand. So they don't necessarily really, you know, they have the belief that we're better than them. Sure, we've played them 3 times. I've played them 3 times and we've beaten them twice. So what's the problem here? There's no hang-up. Yes, they're trying to make history in the sense that they're... You know, they're trying to get to their first semi-final, but that I think against New Zealand is a moot point because they're playing New Zealand. They have to be on the best of the game to win. So I don't think that history thing is a factor today, and I think that makes Ireland very dangerous from a New Zealand perspective because the doubt, for once, is in New Zealand's mind because they know that the form of their last 3 games is Right, okay, well, you know, we haven't been the better side when we've met the last couple of times. That creates the doubt there, where Ireland don't have that. Ireland aren't in great form. They've gotten better maybe over the last couple of games. So they're very dangerous. They just go out, they play. You know, you see the likes of Keith Earls speaking during the week that he's like, you know, what's the worst that can happen? You know, we're home. I'm going home to my wife and 3 kids and everyone's healthy. Mm. You know, so there is... a huge amount of perspective from this Irish side, especially over the last week. And I think that puts all the pressure on New Zealand. Now, New Zealand live with that every time. Every time they play, people raise their game. So, but I think that that stands for something for Ireland today, and it makes them very, very dangerous.
Yeah, you mentioned the doubt, like putting the doubt in New Zealand's mind. And granted, he wasn't playing 12 months ago, but one man who's been really good over the last few years at putting doubt in New Zealand's mind is Conor Murray, mixing things up kind of at the base of the ruck. 2016, he got his try from just a little quick pick and go, you know, a little pick and go, and just varying play a little bit. I know we had Justin Marshall on speaking with Owen in Japan during the week, and he was talking about how Murray isn't really doing enough of that anymore. It's kind of a lot dependent on kicking and just the simple passing. If Murray was to kind of vary things a little bit and, you know, make New Zealand maybe commit a couple of players into the rucks and then maybe, you know, keep passing it, then all of a sudden when they start moving players out, go for it again. Is that going to be key to creating that bit of doubt?
Yeah, I think, you know, both, they have to vary their game. They can't just rely on the kick-kick battle. They have to make, you know, I'm sure we're going to see a couple of Joe Smith's power plays, which will give variety to the game, and they have to be able to take those opportunities. If they create something, and if that is just a slip pillar and Murray sees it and he goes for it, they have to be able to see them and take those opportunities. Feel the freedom that if there's something on, they go for it, because you're not going to get that opportunity again. New Zealand will see that and they'll close that opportunity at next phase or third or fourth phase after that. So, yeah, look, they have to have potentially the game of their lives. Is it in them? 100%. Yeah, but the variety, and I think little things are interesting that not a lot of people are picking up. The fact that only Johnny Sexton arrived to the team run where all the media are yesterday, that's a bit of, you know, it's like, well, oh, they did their team run behind closed doors, away from everyone else, and like it's not even given any video footage that New Zealand can look at. I know there's nothing in those times anyway, but even having, you know, New Zealand press there, all that, it's all a kind of bit like, well, that's a bit odd. They've been quite, you know, Joe Smith has been in his interview before, and he's like, you know, we've a very simplistic view. We want to get, you know, back to basics, all that kind of stuff. I think you're going to see a couple of power plays that we might not have never seen before, or something from a long, long time ago that people are like, oh, maybe they have been holding back. You know, even Johnny Sexton last week said, yeah, well, you know, potentially we might have been holding something back, but, you know, that's for you to see. So there is these little things throughout the week that New Zealand might pick up on, might not. But for me, I just found that team run thing especially a bit, oh, that's interesting. Why have they done that? Mm. So
I think they were saying, I saw a couple of people making the point, I think Ireland, where they were based this week, roughly about an hour away or so from the stadium. I think some were kind of saying, maybe is it just the travel thing going the whole way just to run around?
Yeah,
a bit?
I get that, but, you know, is it that? You know, like, I just think there are a few things throughout the week that people can pick up on. You know, Johnny even referencing, you know,
he was remarkably relaxed yesterday.
Yeah, and he referenced, I think 2006 or 2017, when basically saying, well, you know, basically the laws have been changed because of, you know, because of how New Zealand played that day, and they'd be red cards today. Mm. So he's not calling them out, because he corrects in a sentence later, but, you know, they're playing exceptionally well, but he's still giving to them a small bit,
yeah,
in a nice undercurrent, and I think that's good to see. You know, there's a bit of bite about everything, and throughout the week that's been really, really good to see.
All right, less than 10 minutes to go now until kickoff in Tokyo. Final couple of questions. How much of what happens today is going to define Joe Schmidt's legacy with Ireland?
I think, you know, it's hard not to view as this is his swan song, in terms of, you know, he's had a 4-year block of preparation to this World Cup. He's developed a squad, a legitimate squad of 35, 36, where that was lacking, you know, 4 years ago. I think everything he's been in total control of that. So this is what he's probably going to be graded on. Yes, he's been the best by far. He has changed the landscape of Irish rugby, provincial rugby, Irish rugby completely. But people will always reference this, in my opinion, as to where he falls. But you have to look at his whole period in Ireland and what he's done for the game, rather than just today. But you know, Ireland we're very harsh on things like that at times as a nation, and I think this is probably what he's going to be remembered for. I think that's wrong, but it's very hard to see the papers tomorrow, if they don't win today, referring to what's been over the last 10, 12 years rather than what's gone on now.
All right, teams coming out onto the pitch. Final word, Johnny. What's it going to be?
I think they'll beat the handicap, which is, I think, 11 points at the moment. I'd love to see them do it. If they're going to do it, it's going to be 3 or 4 points. But I think they'll beat the handicap, so I'm going to sit on the fence and smile.
All right, final couple of texts. Teams coming out onto the pitch. Starlam says, let's go All Blacks. Wolf Ticket says, All Blacks all the way. The Irish have this one from Luca Animations. Fionn Chernick says, Ireland 33, New Zealand 29. Mark O'Callaghan says that this New Zealand team are well beatable. Paranara Gordon Rirenui says whoever can dominate up front will go a long way to winning. And Frankie W, Ireland can win this, keep it tight and the opportunities will come. Best wishes from Scotland. That is where we're going to leave it on this preview show for Ireland and New Zealand. Teams walking out onto the pitch as I speak. Ireland and New Zealand kicks off in 5 minutes. Join us back on Off the Ball at 1 o'clock. Johnny will be with us, Nathan will be back in studio, and Michael Swift is going to come in as well, when we should be coming up towards the final whistle, and we're going to see whether or not Ireland are going to be in a World Cup semi-final. We'll speak to you then.